this short presentation just to give you a flavour of what we think we bring to the contract and demonstrate some of our company philosophies and some of our values. We've got a strong value maintenance management team. We are experienced and understand being customer focused. Management team brings the contract between delivered maintenance contracts in the Northwest for over 20 years. And teams focused on collaboration, and the senior members introduced into the team are all based locally. And we've got some guys who actually live on, but also have a vested interest in the success of the contract. And by success, I mean that means delivering an excellent service to the people. We're all using the combined team, that's ourselves, and we're all maintaining the network. My emphasis is always on building strong relationships, and the team's got a proven culture of collaboration. And that's described within this, which was set up initially to deal with the initial setup, but it's got the flexibility in there to change over time as our relationships maybe change. Our customer focus starts with joining us to consider a constructed scheme. And we've already had two inspections on the contract so far. The contract's been awarded a certificate of compliance already, which means we are achieving all levels that they assess at that. We showed improvement between the two visits. We developed customer feedback questionnaires, and we trialled those, and they're now in use. And they've been designed around the five key objectives of the considered constructive scheme. That's care about the appearance, respect for the community, protecting the environment, securing everyone's safety, and valuing our workforce. We try to encourage our team leaders and our managers to interact with the public when they've got issues and deal with them face-to-face in person so that they can understand what the problems are, and we explain the how and the why we do things as a partnership. And it's important to us that we explain that we do it as a partnership. It's not about us, or it's not where it's working together. And some of the solutions we come up with are always desirable to people. People don't always like service dressing, because explaining is the best way to spend the budgets. On the recent coastal defence scheme that we had, the site team decided to put up a daily bulletin board, but they filled in what the planned activities were for the day, just to keep the public informed. They put the planned activities for the day, weather forecast and time, so it's all about letting people know what's happening. We've encouraged the introduction of our Whilst We Were There initiative, which was developed on one of our previous contracts by the team, the traffic management teams. And it involves them using the general housekeeping work, so cleaning signs, clearing vegetation during any dead time that they have, because they're sometimes in gangs are waiting for concrete to be delivered, sometimes the traffic management team between setups are going to be the dead time, so it's doing stuff to it. But it's their idea, they thought about it. As Brian said in the report, we've got a suite of contract KPIs to measure our performance across the service delivery. We also produce progress graphs against the key budget areas to report to the strategic and operations boards. We've reproduced the summary graph on this report. You can't see the detail, so I've basically just pulled off the graph that relates to the complaints that we've had. The red and blue graphs on there, the previous 2 years, just a comparison. Trend to date shows a real success story in driving down complaints, and we hope you can continue with this trend. We're currently performing well against the contract KPIs, but we'll continue to monitor them, and we'll obviously use this year's achievements to set ever more demanding targets for next year. These graphs are from the monthly progress report of the 7th of December for structural maintenance. We've got similar ones for all the other service delivery areas. Again, I've pulled off some of the detail from the footways graph. You can see from that we're able to monitor where work is issued to us against the budget. You can see when we've actually completed the work and ultimately when we're actually getting paid for it. One of the obligations that Balance will take seriously on these sorts of contracts is to develop our employees for the future provision of the service. We know that we need to leave a sustainable resource to safeguard the delivery of the highway service in the world at the end of our tenure, be that 4 years, 6 years, 10 years, what have you. We know we're training people for a sustainable service for the future. With this in mind, we are committed to training and developing our employees. This process has already started with the annual performance and development meetings, which are used to inform the annual training programme It also enables us to discuss individuals' performance with them and also their own aspirations for the future. We've just done this sort of training that we've carried out in the first year of the contract. That's included the continued commitment to apprentices, to sponsorship of their release courses, occupational health and safety and environmental. And we've also delivered our Beyond Zero workshops. They're delivered by our own employees, and these are guys who volunteered to deliver this training program, which is an ambitious behaviour training program. They've stood up in there and sort of in front of people and delivered these courses. The aim of Beyond Zero is to develop a caring culture which focuses on respect for people, respect for the community, respect for the environment. We've delivered this to all our new employees, to all our key supply chain that work on the contract on a day-to-day basis, and to some rural staff as well. In the first year, we even had our HGV drivers back on bikes as part of a CPC training day, just to make them aware of cyclists when they're driving. Some of the guys haven't been on bikes for about 40 years, so there's one or two entertaining incidents in there. We bring with us a supply chain that we've got long-established relationships with from previous term contracts. So we already know how each of us work, the teams work, and we know how each of us click. So we have another steep learning curve where we know what we know, how to deliver the work on site. As Brian says, they brought innovative processes and materials such as DuraPatch and TechFan. DuraPatch, as Brian said, is a hand-applied system, and that's being used across the borough now to fix potholes. It's funded by the pothole fund, secured from DFT last year. Our supply chain has invested heavily in new equipment and facilities. Keely, who are our specialist service treatment contractor, has a modern fleet of state-of-the-art equipment and vehicles, and that enabled them to deliver last year's surface dressing micro-asphalt program speedily and efficiently. And on our road lines, we're based on the port, providing one-stop shop for road markings. They made a significant investment in a new facility in Elsmore Court, where they can actually manufacture their own line materials. They then have the ability to lay them, but they've also got the ability to manufacture their own specialist vehicles to carry out the work, so a one-stop shop. I say we bring our own contractors, but we've also continued some subcontractors that have worked on the previous contracts, where they had a proven record of successful service delivery. We're also committed to using local SMEs and suppliers, and we're aware that this has a positive benefit on the economic welfare of rural America. We don't want to fix the value as a world. As a company, we place health and safety of our employees and the people affected by work as our top priority. We are encouraging high standards of housekeeping, cleanliness of vehicles, and cleanliness of site for the workforce. We have minimum standards of mandatory PPE, which are aimed at safeguarding individuals against the main hazards they will encounter on a day-to-day basis. Our contract-based health and safety advisor works with operational teams to work on safe methods of work and to support training. She's supported by our national and our local resources. Contract Health and Safety Committee has been established, and the members are drawn from the various disciplines across the organisation, and I've charged them with being a proactive unit, and we work together to look at the issues raised by the workforce, but I also tell them I expect them to bring possible solutions to the table. One thing I'm very personally keen on is encouraging our team to give something back to the communities in which we work. In the main, we're all local, so we want to see our communities prosper. As a company, we're committed to giving back a percentage of our profits to the local communities through sponsorship, through charitable donations, and through time freely given by employees. And BAM's recently introduced a scheme where employees can take a day's paid leave each year to work with community groups and charities. During the first year, we've helped a number of organisations, including Friends of Egremont, the RNLI at Hoylink, the Royal Autistic Society, Royal British Legion, a number of youth sports groups have helped, rural place services and others, by providing time and resources, including signs and traffic management equipment. We sit on the employer steering group in the World Chamber of Commerce. We've had employers attend training days that have been organised by them on such topics as delivering a first-class customer experience and building effective teams. It's a relationship we would like to continue and develop with the chamber because we feel it's important for us to belong to it. We have employees in our team signed up on Inspiring the Future initiative, which aims to connect schools with volunteers prepared to give their time to talk to pupils on what jobs they do, potential career paths, and also possible hurdles. So we've provided work experience to young people in the first year. At the very end of the spectrum, we're working with Rural Elder People's Parliament to install brightly coloured benches on the right promenade using recycled materials. That brings us to the end of the presentation. The first year of the contract is only at the bay in time. We get to know the people that transfer to us, we get to know Rural. But I think from our point of view, we feel that the first year of the contract is really successful, and we'd like to build on that success for the future. It's been a brief presentation. I hope we've given something on our company ethos, our operating principles, some of the benefits we bring to the world, and hopefully show you that we want to make this contract a collaborative success for everyone.
Would anyone like to
speak
to the
contract?
So we have got a backlog at the moment. I think along around about 800 orders, I think at the moment. And talking to our lighting team today, we're working hard to get on top of that client and contractor resources. And certainly within the next couple of weeks, we're hoping to get to the stage where when those reports come in, we're back to the normal response times for dealing with things, which obviously we recognise over the last few weeks hasn't necessarily been the case. Thank you.
Thanks, Jack. I just think what the community initiatives that you've got going there. Can I ask, are you a living wage organisation?
I'd have to ask our HR.
Well, we perhaps come at it from a different angle. We're signed up to the working rule agreement for all of our employees. Obviously, those that cheap and transfer to us. We've got the requirement to maintain their terms and conditions. So that's the mixture that we've got. So you've got a well-established working rule agreement arrangement for the majority of our hourly paid employees. We've got the ban on the terms and conditions for our employees. And where we've got duty transfer staff, they're already on their transferring conditions. So without being able to answer your question directly, my working assumption would be that all of that would be in line with what your question was asking.
Thank you. Thanks, Trina. Joe? Anybody else? Steve?
Obviously the presentation was very informative. Is the only question I think of is, does balance stand for anything?
Oh, crikey.
It does.
It does, but you don't want to know.
We're a Dutch-owned company, so we're a privately owned organisation, owned by a group, which is a Dutch-based group that's floated on the Dutch Stock Exchange. You're more than welcome to have a quick look at the BAM, Royal BAM website, where it does tell you what BAM stands for. And you find in Holland there are quite a few sort of three-letter acronym type companies. There tend to be three words that are about this long for those initials, so that's why we're BAM.
It's about the honest company with big double games and double classes.
Thanks, Chair. No, it's absolutely refreshing to see a company that's got a focus purely on the will, that you're looking at maintaining the existing SMEs and the contracts that obviously they've been helping here. It's even nicer to see pictures of you, Greg.
That's
a little bit. You said you do work with community groups, I mean, named a few like Egremont, etc. How do you select which groups to work with, or do they come to you? How does that work exactly?
They do tend to come to us. Sometimes we get asked by employees if we can help. But it does tend to go out of the word of mouth, or if you put it out there, it's there. We would have to be inundated with requests. There's obviously only so many we can do. We're managing to handle it. A lot of it is traffic management equipment. Like the Royal British Legion one, I think there's a Prince Charles visit to Royal British Legion, and they have the pedestrian barriers, and we can go down and sort it down. So there's those sorts of things that we can do with really easy.
So between you and I and YouTube, it's sort of keep it okay.
I know.
I can see nothing.
Well, then we have to start being selective.
Thanks,
sir.
Hey, everyone. Thanks very much, gentlemen. That was an excellent presentation. And for me, you hit all the right buttons there. And you said all the right words. Flexibility, customer awareness, all the things that I certainly would be looking for. You really did hit the right notes there. And thanks very much for all of the community and the time. And I wish you every success with the whole of the panel. Recommendations.
Over a lengthy period, therefore our ability to do some of the interventions or solutions to, and obviously, thank you, my council members, we would rather be having stretching and improving targets year on year. I think the challenge being though, if you know that there's not going to be the same funds available, we need to be able to follow to set the target.
Just one on that, yeah, totally understand that. But with regards to interventions to improve programmes and sector properties, do we see this target for 15-16 improving with the additional money that's been put in for the select licensing?
The short answer to that then is yes.
Denise,
yes.
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to bring up about the empty properties, Helen. I'm just not... I mean, you say the forecast was 260, but the actual fund...
If you look at year-to-date target 2014-15, the target to this point in time when this measure was taken was 80. We've actually achieved 82 year-to-date performance, so you're actually above.
So how many have we still got left on one? Sorry.
How many empty? The last count was just over 6,000.
Thank you, Chair. Two questions. One is in relation to performance number three, which is the only thing that we've got in that level. Although I will always see an outlet, although we will change from that. We will improve. The information is from Merseyside Police, but one of the problems is that the L53 is a category that's in our domain. It's actually Cheshire Police that look after that. So we can get away with anything, or we still just get all the figures because it's a bit windmill.
Yes. I wouldn't call it getting away with it, Chair.
No, I
would
not. Yes, you know
what
I'm saying. Absolutely, some of the M53 within the world of here, which counts against us.
Counts against us, you know, the information. Okay. And the other one is in relation to number 15, and that's Rosemary, I think, the head of population. People who have been working for 12 months, the investment strategy. Could you tell me how much more we've been able to do the extra grant we received from governments in the last couple of months in relation to it?
Sorry, what extra grant?
The £51,000 went to the regional development in Merseyside. And also, question on that. We are aiming to be one of the leading areas for development of new infrastructure to supply the car industries. I noticed it's on the TV today that Wellington have just been allocated a new industry in relation to that. Would you like to make a comment on that, please?
Yes, Chair. So I'm assuming you talked to the second round of growth funding that was announced about 3 weeks ago. Well, that was announced, hasn't actually been received yet. So, you know, how's that having an impact? It's not yet.
Not yet. Okay, thank you.
That's actually been received. In terms of the car plant at the car facility at Warrington. Congratulations to Warrington for securing that investment. And obviously, we are in competition. I don't know how to use the word. A number of areas over automotive parts. Warrington, I think it's fair to say, is quite envious on occasion in terms of it has significant funds available and its resources to support investment from businesses. So that's not saying we don't, but Warrington has more than us, or makes more than us available. I just would like to say something on this report, Chair, and this particular measure seems out. This report goes up to the 30th of November 2014. GVA measure number 15 is measured annually, so every December the government releases its new GVA stats. So this December, after this report deadline, was the new GVA stats for 2013 were issued. I'm pleased to say, Chair, Wirral's GVA increased by 7% in year. which is the highest anywhere in the country. So not just in the Liverpool situation in the northwest, but our GVA increased last year, so the value of our economy increased by 7%, which was higher than anywhere else in the country. Chair, could you give this to me then, not to say this, but I'll come back to Dave's first question about number of people killed or seriously injured. It is a measure that I hope that does go to the green, but Dave's right, unfortunately, we have a particular problem in the world because of the M53 motorway, which we have no influence over whatsoever. We're also, I think, members are aware, we do have a high number of incidents that count towards that total from the more mature motorcyclists who tend to use Wirral to get out to their weekend jaunts over in North Wales down the country roads, and we do have significant issues. We have been able to reduce those figures or try and manage those figures through funds that we've managed to secure in the past from central government. Those funds are now finished. We are hopefully going to be able to secure funds through our public health policy, because the number of people killed or seriously injured is a public health key indicator as well. So we carry on the work, which is largely around education, not only in the schools, but also to monitor some of the people in terms of the dangers of bad driving and pedestrians to be more careful.
Chair, just to add, we're doing exactly that, but interestingly, this isn't just a Wirral problem. That struggling against that target, all of the Merseyside authorities coincidentally are a similar percentage adrift from where we want to be.
Thank you.
Yeah, another
excellent
report. it's worth noting, you know, our road safety manager, who works with Mark. It took a week off the meeting because motorcycle accidents were increasing. He took a week off work and paid his own money to go on the advance. He's a motorcyclist himself, Dave. And he took a week off in his own time to pay his money to do the advance motorcycle course to see if there was anything he could pick up on that would help him in his job. And that's how diligent he is. But that department's being cut as well, so it's becoming harder and harder for me. And they are working really, really hard. Okay. local recommendations? Agreed? Agreed. Thank you. Move on to the next item on the agenda. Financial monitoring. That's Kevin again, pages 47 to 56.
Again, Chair, nothing to add to the floor. Mark, you will lead our very able accountant who sat at the back of the room since 6 o'clock. So, any questions, Mark, David, to answer them. Pleased to say, Chair, in terms of both our revenue budgets, we are doing well. We have contributed some savings to support the Council's overall financial position. In terms of our Council fund budgets, we are spending, Chair, some works that have some slips, some deliberately put back, but we do expect to come in on more budgets.
Any questions on that? Okay.
Just one quick question, and it's in relation to 3.9. Could you explain how much we've spent on machinery in relation to the parks since we brought it back in house?
Sure. Mark?
It's a nice figure.
Let everybody know by email.
I think it's fair to say, Chair, we let members of the committee know by email.
Thank you.
Which are the people who work with the Liverpool Council, We're working with the local city region to supply training and things for that. And they are good. And also, the partner's head of European affairs in the local city council. So he was there to give us overview as well. It was a lot of funding, of course, that the local city region will be getting is from the European Union. So we talked about that. Now, we wanted to do some scrutiny work before the end of this year, so that's May. So what we decided to do is to look at two areas. The commissioning and bidding framework being developed to underpin the local delivery of the European programme, that's the funding. So we decided to scrutinise that. The chair and the vice chair have asked for reports to come in, which they're going to read, and then we're going to have two scrutiny. And the other one is the governance arrangements in place to shape and oversee the local operation and programme. And now this is designed to specifically look at areas where other areas other than Liverpool don't want it to be Liverpool-centric. We don't either. So it was brought up. So we're going to look at that and we're going to scrutinise carefully throughout the next year to make sure that it is, the funding is going out fairly and it's not going, you know, and it isn't Liverpool central. So we want to address those being real fears at my time as well and concerns. So we're going to make sure we address that. And they're the two things we've looked at, and we've got to be quick because we've got the elections coming up in May, and in any other business I'm going to mentioned that very briefly. So we're going to do all that, and we're going to have a meeting. And I think I'm right, Mike, in saying that we're going to meet twice in March on the scrutiny to look at both of these things, and then we're going to agree for a panel meeting on the 8th of April.
Two open sessions, a wrap-up meeting, final recommendations to be heavily reported to the panel. Formal panel on the 8th of April. So this is still subject to approval by the chair of the scrutiny panel. So the scope of the documents have been introduced. I think it's in the process of being circulated to the scrutiny panel.
Yeah, we still haven't had it yet.
So that's where that's going.
Thank you for that, Mike. Is everybody okay with that? Any questions? Not that I can answer them. Any gone to these?
I was just wondering if we were discussing this before, Chair. I thought you said something to do with homelessness.
That's all. I think that's our word.
That's the next item two. Next agenda.
That's seven. So we want to look at that as well. So So that's really the scrutiny question.
Sorry. I wanted to bring an item up which really concerns me, and I've been, it's been going on for a long time. Utility companies have got a major issue with the world at the moment. Utility companies running a mock national grid, BT, wrecking cables, and I would like to see these people brought to committees, particularly national grid and BT, because the messages that they're going around wrecking cables,
we'll put that in the web program, Jerry, okay?
That's
right. Anyone else?
Can I just quickly add to what Councillor has just said? Yes, and obviously that's good, Chair. We are moving, we did put in the budget option to move towards a payment authority.
Yeah,
to try and get more of a control over the way that these utilities do. But it still is an issue now, so let's have it.
It's a point well made, Jerry. We'll look at that next year also. Denise, did you want to make a point?
It's on this bit now. The under occupancy, 5.1, that's, I take it that's got to be one of the ones as well. Can we bring back the people that we had 2 years ago that came into us? Is that just what we were seeking to do?
What did we do?
You weren't here then.
2 years ago, what?
Well,
what's it on?
We had a group that came and seen us. Did you want a day?
No, I wasn't talking to you.
Chair, I can answer that.
Yeah.
Chair, one of the pieces of work that the committee did a couple of years ago was to look at the issue of changes in the benefits and how that was affecting individuals. And one of the pieces of work that was done was around under occupancy. And there were a number of voluntary organisations and RSLs that were asked to come along and be with members. A report was produced. And I think that report probably did say that there would be a review at some point. So, can I want to.
You mentioned about the item going on the agenda for next year. And how can for the next meeting?
We can't do it honestly, we can't.
It's become such a
huge problem. James,